You'll notice there's a lot of cuts here, and so I'll plow through that quickly at X2, X4 speeds, stop, start, and you'll notice also the CPU in this regard, it's very up and down. This is where you need latency on a CPU. It's very important for snapping quickly between different actions when you're doing this kind of work. Over the last 5 years here at Tech Yes City, I've gone from using my main rig, which has had a 4-core, 8-threaded CPU, all the way up to 32 cores, 64 threads. And I love just trying different rigs to see how they handle 4K video editing. My previous rig was an X299 system, and actually just recently I switched over to a 10900K. However, here today, I'm now gonna be switching over to a 3950X because I love experimenting what the latest and greatest can do for a workflow, not just for me, but also when I'm recommending PCs to other people, I get an idea of the strengths and weaknesses. Because I'm gonna say one thing straight up, and that is that there's no magical CPU that can do everything the best. It just doesn't exist. There's different types of parts for different people with different needs. Hence, I guess why there's so many different product SKUs out there, more than there has ever been in the history of technology. And I guess the reason for that is there's much more users with much more peculiar needs. So over the last few years, my personal needs out of a CPU, I need something that's lightning snappy. I need it to be quick. When I'm doing a lot of actions per minute, cutting footage, editing, and then throwing footage over the top of that, I want something that's really responsive, something that can quickly drop clips in. And so in relation to this one need in particular, it's not always about more cores, more threads, because the more cores and more threads you add to a CPU, you are actually adding latency. Anyhow, in today's video, we're going with the 3950X, 16 cores, 32 threads. I feel for me personally, this is gonna give me the best balance between cores and threads versus latency. Though we will talk a little bit about that later once we give this rig a trial run. Then for other parts, we're going with the 280X from Corsair. Great small case, as well as having good airflow and good build quality. Then for the cooler, we're going with the H115i Pro XT series. This is similar to the RGB Platinum, except you're getting a newer pump head and you're minus the RGB on the fans themselves. Then for the drive, Gen 4 PCIe X4 NVMe 1TB SSD. I wanna utilize what PCIe Gen 4 has to offer. Since AMD is currently offering this and Intel's not, I feel like it could help me for video editing. For the motherboard, we're going with the B550 Phantom Gaming ITX from ASRock. I recently reviewed this motherboard. I really liked the numbers it was putting out. Not only that, it boosts all these 16 cores out of the box over 4 GHz, which is gonna be great for me for video editing, considering that is a stable 24/7 4 GHz that I can reliably use when I'm video editing. Though I know some of you guys out there will be scratching your heads like, why are you using a mini ITX board in a micro ATX case? And to answer that question straight up, I'm going down a tangent of latency again. I do go down these tangents here at Tech Yes City because I like to just gain my own knowledge and gain my own experience with things so I can make recommendations off that. And I feel like mini ITX, all other things equal, is going to give you the best latency versus bigger motherboards. And I've actually seen this in tests in the past where I've tested A320 budget boards, and because they've been so small, they've actually given out slightly better numbers than their bigger ATX counterparts. And because we're using a mini ITX motherboard, we only get 2 slots of memory available. So we're going with 2 32GB DIMMs of Corsair Vengeance Pro RGB memory. And this is clocked at 3000MHz XMP. Now, when you're going with 64GB, this much memory will start to put a strain on the IMC. So if we're going with a 16GB kit, for example, we could easily put 4400MHz XMPs on this thing and it'd be fine. But because we're going with 32GB DIMMs, we do have to be careful with those XMP profiles. Though the last components in this build, RTX 2080 Ti, I need this for video editing because Adobe now supports RTX Studio driver set, and that does give you a massive boost in the Premiere Pros, especially in final render times, but also GPU accelerated effects and everything else that's GPU accelerated within Premiere Pro itself. You are gonna be gaining a lot by using an NVIDIA RTX card where they have done a lot of work on the driver set. And the last piece is the power supply. We're going with an SF750 small form factor power supply. Even though this fits a standard ATX power supply, I've just got this lying around the studio, which I pulled apart my whole travel PC because, let's face it, with the world situation right now, I don't know when traveling is going to be, the restrictions on travel is gonna be lifted. So I might as well make use of parts instead of them collecting dust. However, with that aside, let's get this thing built and show you guys all the tuning and also first impressions after I edit some videos on this thing to see how it goes. So I've now cut the first bit of this video, the voice work, and you'll notice there is a lot of cuts here, and that's because I don't script my videos. Like, I very rarely do a scripted video here at Tech Yes City. And so this is what it's gonna look like, because you're gonna make a few mistakes when you've got absolutely no script to go off. But at least that being said, I like to give you guys the videos straight from the heart. And so that's what you're getting here all the time. But you'll notice with the CPU utilization here, it's really taking the CPU through all these twists and turns. It's not just all cores utilized all the time when you're editing videos. And so for other YouTubers, they might have a different workflow. That's great for them. But what you'll notice here from the CPU utilization on Performance Manager is that I'm still using quite a few cores and threads, but because I'm snapping and doing so many actions at once, I need that initial latency there as well, because I'm going from sometimes X2 to X4 speeds, monitoring the voice work back and forth. So this is very important to have that CPU that's not only fast, but I guess can turn the corners. If we're gonna go for an analogy of a car here, we've gotta have a car that's not too heavy and can still take the corners fine, but at the end of the day, still has the acceleration and speed to get to the finish line quickly. But now we'll get on to editing the build montage footage for you guys. And this is a different process to the previous process we just did here with the voice work. Because we're gonna be adding so many different layers on, we actually need to utilize now a bit more memory bandwidth than we did before. So how's the 3950X gonna pass with first impressions? Let's give it a go. So here's the next stage in a typical edit, especially if I'm doing a PC build. Now we've got the montage right here, and this is where there's many different layers, and I'll show you how the CPU is bouncing up and down here in utilization, where this thing is starting to get worked. This 3950X, it's getting worked. Now this is probably, sometimes this is the most strenuous part of an edit, especially if we're dropping in effects, color inverts, and whatnot. And I do notice there is a little bit of a struggle, but that does also happen on Intel as well. I can push this CPU's, even like the 7980XE overclocked to 4.4 all core, 10900K running at 5 GHz. These CPUs, I can bring them to their knees in this part. And I'm happy to say here, this is easily, and I mean easily, the best experience I've had on an AMD CPU. It's in a different league to second and first gen CPUs that I've brought through and tried to run as my main rig. And this is one of those things where we'll move over to a conclusion soon and we'll talk about this whole process, first impressions already, but I'm definitely gonna be staying on this because it's really nice. Like, it's good to see AMD are competing with Intel with third gen, like really competing at the fine details, on the fine line. And this is really impressive so far. Like, me smashing through my workflow, I noticed these things, and that's why in the past I went from an 8-core Xeon, for example, which was overclocked, to the 18-core, and that was my main rig for quite some time here at the channel. But now with the 10th gen going at 10 cores, 20 threads being ring bus versus that mesh architecture, and now AMD with their third gen, I wanna try these things out at the same time and see which is really the best. But anyway, with this piece aside, let's sit down and talk about this rig and everything going forward with the 3950X. 100% organic 3950X. That is what this experience is so far. And first impressions, but first impressions do last. And I do say, like I said in the montage footage before, the first and second gen Ryzen, I feel, weren't anywhere near as good as the 3950X experience I've had here today. And the reason I say that is because people have said, okay, you've got to do this tweak, you've got to do this, you've got to do that. And basically all I've done here is installed AMD's chipset drivers, I've installed the basis and the baseline stuff, the NVIDIA drivers, and this is what I did on the previous AMD systems. And this is a big difference. I haven't disabled threaded optimization or anything like that. People are telling me, oh, you got to disable threaded optimization in the NVIDIA drivers. I haven't done that, and I'm getting a much better experience. Now, over the coming months, I'm going to try all these tweaks that people recommend and see how they apply to my setup and my workflow. And that's the big thing. When I come back and report to you guys in a few months' time what it's been like on this system right here, I'm gonna come back and say, okay, this tweak made a difference or it didn't make a difference. But bottom line is, when it comes to comparing apples to apples to the previous AMD systems I've used, 3950X is awesome. And I do say AMD systems. You probably noticed why I've said AMD systems, because the Intel systems are doing very well on this workflow too. The 10900K and the 7980XE I had before that, they were really good. And the 3950X is in that league. That's how I feel, that's how good this thing is. And that's a great thing, because when people come to me, I don't, like, there's no fanboy arguments around here. I do not care one bit about the fanboys, because when it comes down to it, I'm building people PCs locally here, or people are asking me for recommendations. I want to give them the right recommendation. And that's what it's all about, giving people the right recommendation, whether it's value for money. And in that case, I do recommend Ryzen a lot. But now when it comes to video editing, I'm going to be telling people, you might want to consider the 3950X, because it's really good, especially if you want the most for your dollar. It's coming and it's comparing to the 10900K, it's comparing to the 7980XE. Now, I won't know this recommendation for another couple of months once I've given it a full test drive, but there are things that I'm noticing is a lot better already. Anyhow, going forward from here, latency, it's a real thing. It's a big thing, for me personally anyway. I don't know about other people and their workflows, but I feel like this is one area AMD has improved a lot on. And I'm hoping with Zen 3, which I know we'll get better performance out of, but I'm also hoping they improve the latency even more to make them just top dog in every single category. Because that's what, as a tech enthusiast, that's what I want personally. And I know a lot of you people out there, you're just like me, especially the guys who have subscribed over the years. You don't care about the brand name. You just want the best experience and you want the best product, especially for the money. And so this one here is definitely hitting hard in terms of being a workstation beast of a CPU. Anyway, with that aside, do let us know in the comment section below, did you enjoy this video? And I know there's not any gaming figures or any gaming benchmarks in today's video, but this was more of a personal video where I'm showing you guys what I actually do with the computer
most of the time, and I actually don't play games a whole lot around here besides benchmarking, and even then, I'm not playing the games, I'm just hitting the benchmark start, benchmark stop. Very repetitive, very boring compared to the real thing. And the thing is, you can't do the real thing because it's then not a equal comparison. So that's my gaming life at the moment. Hopefully this 3950X will free up more time so I can play some more games. Anyways, don't forget to hit that like button. Also, if you're a hater, don't forget to hit the dislike button. All helps with engagement. And if you've stayed this far and you're enjoying the content, and as always, and you want to see the moment it drops, hit the sub button, ring that bell, and I'll catch you guys in the next tech video very soon. Peace out for now. Bye.